record. Rock and Roll Geek Show 1287.
Still rocking after all these years.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
This is it, the show that started it all. Often imitated, but never equal. From San Francisco, USA. Online since 2004. Right. It's the one and only Rock and Roll Geek Show. With the original rock and roll geek, Michael Butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name is Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Friday, 7:06 p.m. and it is, or excuse me, it's Friday, April 19th, and it's 7:06 p.m. when I'm recording this episode. Happy Ian Hunter release day, friends. I did not do a show earlier this week because my wife was in town, and I didn't want to have to throw her out of Don's den to do a show, but I'm here Friday. I ordered the new Ian Hunter CD, and I was praying that it would arrive in time. I've listened to it I'm on probably the fourth time listening to it, so I'm going to do a track by track tonight. And I received in the mail, coincidentally, a book called On Track, Ian Hunter, Every Album, Every Song. This book was sent to me by the author and his publisher. The author's name is G. Mick Smith, and I just happened to have G. Mick Smith on the phone with me to talk. We're going to do a track by track of the new Ian Hunter album together and talk about his. How you doing, G?
I'm doing fantastic. It's Mick, just like Ronson. Mick.
What does G stand for?
It stands for, are you ready, Michael?
Gordon?
Absolutely nothing.
It just stands for G. I'm Gordon Smith.
Yeah, it's after Harry S. Truman, and people want to know what does the S stand for, and it's the same answer. Absolutely nothing.
Oh, okay. So you are, I'm looking at your bio. I just got the book 3 days ago, and when I got it, I was looking through it. It goes through every single song off of every Ian, it's only the solo albums, right?
That is correct. Everything from 75 on.
You're a huge Ian Hunter fan, I'm assuming.
I would assume that would be correct. I first saw him September 14th, 1973.
Is this the only every album, every song book you've released?
This is the only one that actually is on Ian Hunter's solo songs. So, and it's the only one I've done. I've done some other things, but this is the only one on Hunter. And it's the only one that I have done.
I'm going to read your bio here. By the way, thank you for coming on the Rock and Roll Geek Show. I really appreciate it.
I am honored to be on this type of show. Someone knowledgeable about music, I'm there.
All right. Well, I'm honored to have you on. PhD, G. Mick Smith, PhD, the Doctor of Digital. Is there a PhD in digital?
There isn't, but there should be, because yes. I was a traditional liberal arts professor, but I moved into business and technology.
A liberal arts professor?
Yes, sir.
So you teach?
I have. I'm a recovering academic. I don't do it directly anymore. I'm more into podcasting. So I still educate, but in a little different way and not in a formal university setting anymore.
So you taught at a college?
I taught at numerous colleges, yes.
Oh, really? What was the last college you taught at?
That would be Strayer University around Philadelphia and Delaware.
Is that where you live in Philadelphia?
I am not. I had lived in there in that area for 25 years, but I moved back to California, a place I swore I would never come back to.
Oh,
but
really?
Some of us, yes, you can't get away from California. You know, so you just can't never leave, some band said at one time.
I'm here too. You're not in San Francisco, are you?
No, sir. I'm in San Diego, so a little bit further south.
That's too bad. I was going to say, well, why didn't you come over here? We'd just done it in the house together. Although my daughter wants me out of the house, so she would have thrown us out. So I'm going to finish reading the bio. I've made it to almost through the first sentence. You're a consultant and a recovering academic. What do you consult?
I do coaching and consulting, particularly in the educational and technology field. So anything related to the internet, which could be software, custom software, or educators who need and help in technology.
Any of your customers know that you're an Ian Hunter fanatic?
Well, the ones that I trust, I do, because I have to tell them who he and Hunter is. But oh, really? I occasionally do run into some Hunter fans.
But they know all the young dudes, did you say?
Yeah.
You got to sing all the young dudes to them.
I say, you know, Cleveland Rocks, Once Bitten, Twice Shy, all the young dudes. And I go, oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Great White.
Sometimes I do say Great White. I go, well, actually, no, that was Hunter.
You're the chief digital officer at the Doctor of Digital podcast. So you got a podcast.
Yeah, I've got a couple, but my primary one is the Doctor of Digital podcast.
How long have you been doing a podcast?
I've been at it for a while. It's been 10 years now.
Huh. Do you know how long I've been doing a podcast?
I know it's a long time. You're one of the early guys I know.
I'm in the, you know, did you know that there was a podcast Hall of Fame?
Fame, you know,
a podcast Hall of Fame, like a rock and roll hall of fame, but for podcasters.
I know there's a Mr. Butler in there. I know that.
There you go. You did your research before you came on, huh?
You bet. I'm a researcher. I'm an academic.
What else do you know about Michael Butler?
Well, you have an interesting background because musician, done a lot of different things like that. And you also have a Wikipedia entry, which is pretty impressive.
Really? What does it say? Yes, sir. What's it say on the Wikipedia page? I masturbate a lot.
There's mixed feelings.
Oh, yeah, really?
Just leave it at that.
Oh, is there trashing on the Wikipedia page? I haven't seen it lately.
I wouldn't say it's trashing, but it just things, you know, I wouldn't know. And, you know, I'm not going to take everything I read on Wikipedia without doing further research. So I'll put it that way.
Now I got to look. There's the same. I got into a fight with my wife and I went and.
No, and it's not that personal, though. No.
Does it say I'm a rageaholic or anything like that?
It's not that bad. Really.
Does it say I just got in a fight with my daughter? All right. Okay. You got a podcast. Having formerly been an executive region director and campus dean, you were the dean, huh?
I was a campus dean, yes. But Strayer, as a matter of fact.
Not a high school dean, because the high school dean, I was in high school, they would SWAT. You get like SWATs with the paddle.
Yeah, that was like smoking in the bathroom.
Yeah, you get caught roaming the parking lot and you get a SWAT.
Yeah, that's when you could be roughly my age then, because they did have those. I'm 69.
Oh, okay, I'm 62. So
we're close. You're a young man, though.
There you go. So you earned a PhD in the history of religions from UCLA.
Correct.
Are you practicing? Were you Catholic?
The history of religions is a field. So a famous line from F. Max Mueller, who started history of religions, he said, "If you know one, you know none." So you have to know more than one. You have to know all the world religions.
So is there money in a doctorate of religions?
Well, there's a traditional academic route, and I certainly pursued that, and that's what I thought I was going to do for the rest of my life. But I think then I got into more of the executive side and the technology advising side, the consulting area, and I realized there's other opportunities. And I think there's a lot of things that are drawbacks in the academic field as well, too.
You have nine certificates to executive management and educational technology. You currently reside, pardon me, I need to take a sip of this fine Tecate, or I'm drinking Pacifica in the can. I'm losing my voice here, which is not good for the beginning of the podcast. You currently reside far from the maddening crowd in sunny California, enjoying the parents' first new car, a 57 Buick Special, which is on your Facebook photo. You co-host the Aftermath podcast. What's the Aftermath podcast?
The Aftermath podcast is the epidemic of divorce, custody, and healing. And it's something that did happen to me at one time and wrote a novel on it called Burning America.
And wrote Burning America in the best interest of the children.
That's the one.
Hmm. Did you have a traumatic divorce? Did she file for divorce for you?
I don't want to get into all the details because it's really a better story than you might think. And there's a twist or turn in there. I'll put it that way.
I'm always fascinated by relationships because I have quite a tumultuous, we won't get into that.
Welcome to
Why
the world.
Why can't I get into it? Wait a minute. I don't want to get into it, but I want you to get into it. That's not fair. That makes me a hypocrite. What made you want to write a book about Ian Hunter? Now, this is an actual publisher, Sonic Bound, or is that a self-published?
No, they're a pretty respectable English publisher of exclusively music books. That's all they do. So any of the top names you've ever heard of, there's probably a book about them. And what happened was I approached the publisher with a proposal because they had done one on Martha Hoople, and I contacted him and I said, hey, has anybody done one on Ian Hunter? He says, no. And well, I'm the guy. So I sent a proposal, and it's all on music. So that's really his niche. And I told him what the background was and my qualifications. And I said, yeah, really would like to write this. So that's how we moved ahead and got a contract.
So Sonic Bond Publishing, are all their music books, every album, every song?
Well, there's two different main series that they have. That is, one is the On Track series, and the other is the Decade series. So it might be someone like from, well, they did the Martha Hoople one on the 70s, because that's really, other than 69, the first LP, really a 70s band. So they took artists by decade, and then there's also the On Track series.
I have a friend who did one on Cheap Trick, but he self-published it, I believe.
Well, he could be on your next show, because he got Cheap Trick on Defiance Part 2.
Yeah, that's right. That is right. So it starts off with the first solo album. Sometimes I'll do these things, the greatness of, I'll do an artist and I'll just play a bunch of music. And I did one on Ian Hunter, and it was about three hours long.
I saw. Yes, indeed.
Man, I had so much fun doing that, because there's so much good Ian Hunter. What's your favorite Ian Hunter solo album?
There's really a difficult question to answer, because it's very difficult. I'll put it this way. A lot of people like the first one. I fell in love with the second one, which was Commercial Suicide. I think I was just ahead of the game, as I would argue Hunter has been. And there's some over the years that I've really liked. But what I think is interesting him as an artist and a creator, which is, he is now coming out with really incredible first-rate albums in what I consider his third stage after Ronson. Now he's got the solo career, but a 2000 or so. And I just think they're all gems, one after the other.
Can you believe he's 84 years old and putting out quality material still?
No, this is my argument in the book. I'm advancing a thesis like an academic does. I'm going to claim that he deserves to get the Lifetime Achievement Award for rock and roll, and also that he's moved past classic rock. So look, I don't want to step on other people's toes about all those famous bands out there, but look, their music is not as compelling as Ian Hunter, because he has never stopped, and he's 84. I've seen him live dozens of times, and it's just an incredible show.
I prefer Ian Hunter solo to Martha Hoople.
Yeah, and I would just get, express an opinion. Sometimes I listen, there's a lot of nostalgia in there, but when I listen to Mod, I say, what was really the draw here? Because I think you hear a lot of production problems in there. There's the squeak on the drums on the one album. I mean, there's things like that, but it was also part of the recording process, which apparently was pretty chaotic. But I do think some of their outstanding gems are really classic. And I think there's where Hunter emerged as a songwriter. And I think that's one of the best things that could happen, is actually, okay, the band broke up, he got on his own, and he's really doing his own thing.
The first time you saw him, what did you say, 72?
September 14th, 1973. I had a buddy.
So that was towards the end of Martha Hoople.
Correct. Yeah. It was the first live gig that, what they called the stage name, Ariel Bender. It was the first stage act that he was on, and that's why I saw him at the Hollywood Palladium.
And how many times have you seen Ian Hunter solo?
I basically have lost count, but I can give you an idea.
I saw him once. Well, that was Hunter Ronson.
Yes. Well, there you go. That was a great time to see him. That was one of the peaks. But I've seen him three nights in a row in New York City. I've seen him six times in a month traveling through New England, and I've seen him three nights in a row on the West Coast in the LA area. Huh. So yeah, seen him just dozens of times.
Have you ever met Ian Hunter?
I would say it's kind of like casual, you know what I mean? I stay after a gig, I've got a ton of things. And in the book, see what I've done is they also have things like the so-called my collection, because yeah, I've got quite a collection of his material. And so after gigs, I've had him sign some things, the first solo record that he ever got songwriting credit on. some things from the top record stores in Southern Cal at the time, Licorice Pizza, things like that. And I told him, you know, this is the things I've been collecting over the years. And some of them are in the book as well.
Was he impressed at all?
Well, you know, I found him like the odd thing about him, like going from a guy who saw him as a kid and on stage, and he's definitely the rock star and definitely in command. But, you know, after the gig, if you're kind of respectful and just want to chat with him, I mean, he's very friendly. He's really a down to earth kind of person. So this is what other people have told me about him. And that's, yeah, I think that's what I found him. I think, you know, if you show some specific interest, like, for example, I want to stand out, right? Because I don't talk to him that much. When I see him, guys were in the 1980 and the Licorice Pizza, and everybody brought the latest album. Naturally, what I brought was the first Mott the Hoople album. Right. And he kind of looks at it and he says, oh, yeah, this is actually my leather jacket and the heads of all the other members of the band. And I go, okay, well, he gave me a little insight. Mm-hmm. And when I've talked to him, that's kind of what I'm looking for. Yeah, tell me something that the obvious is not obvious and known by everybody.
Does he know about this book?
I'm not sure. I did invite him on the Doctor of Digital podcast at one time, and I'd like to approach him again because it would be a really awesome interview. He just said at one, that time, he said it's not the right time. And I think it's probably because there's different promotional things. But, you know, if a publicist are out there, yeah, I'd love to have him on and chat with him. I wouldn't ask all the same boring questions that reporters have asked him over the years. I really want to know, and I want to dig down. And hopefully some of that material is in the book as well.
Yeah, I've tried to get him on this podcast several times. And I know somebody who knows his daughter, I think, or I think it might be his daughter. And anyway, I know somebody who's in the know with him. I got no response.
Yeah, and I think, you know, it's one of those things. It's like catch can. So it's not like, you know, we hang out and I'm his buddy. You know what I mean? It's right. Like I'm still gonna have to go through his people, so to speak. But I do think since I've tried to talk to him in person and after gigs and things like that and express a very high interest, I've also written in, like other people have, to the horse's mouth, which he's also kind enough to respond to a lot of us people who are asking questions. And speaking of the novel, I did ask him about permission, about writing using some of the lyrics, and he was kind enough to say, yeah, go ahead. So, I mean, there is some sort of contact. It's just a matter of he's not seeking me out. I just have to be persistent and keep asking.
Did you read those two books that he wrote, Diary of a Rock and Roll Star? Did you read that one?
Well, yes, I got a story on almost all of these things. So I was in Cerritos, California. I was living in Southern Cal at the time, and I saw it on the bookshelves of a record store. There were two copies. I bought one, so I got the original. And then also some years later, of course, it was reprinted, and I contacted the publisher of that one. And so I've got the old one and the new one.
Is there different stuff in the new one?
I think there's a little bit of an expansion, okay, yes. Yeah. So there's a more comment on, you know, what has happened in the meantime and what has transpired.
And then there's another book that I also have called Rock and Roll Sweepstakes, which I have not read yet. I read the Diver Rock and Roll Star. Have you read that one?
Well, it's just the title. That's really the difference. And what happened
Is that the same book?
Yeah. The sweepstakes was what Hunter wanted. And I think the publisher went with the other one the other title I thought was more sellable.
So Rock and Roll Sweepstakes is the reissue, and it's got extra stuff in it.
Yeah, I think there's a little bit extra stuff.
All right, I have two copies. I have the old version and the new version. I'm going to read about the last album. What did you think of the last album? It's great, right?
The part one you're talking about then?
Yes.
Yeah. That part one, I just thought, you know, again, was one of those just incredible statements. And I was think the idea of the Lifetime Achievement Award, I think, because people have said, well, why isn't he or shouldn't he be in the Hall of Fame, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? And I go, well, in a way, he doesn't need it. And
Mott the Hoople's not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, are they?
No, nobody is. But
you got to be fucking kidding me, man.
Well, exactly. But who came on part one? I mean, all these luminaries, right? And the entire rock world.
What is going on with that joke of a... Ian Hunter is not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? Oh,
no.
God, what a fucking travesty.
Oh. He wrote the perfect song for them. What do you want? Right? Cleveland
yeah,
Rock.
I know. Yeah, you get me going on the Rock and Roll. I don't want to be. I don't want to pull an Eddie Trunk, but yeah. Here's who played on the Defiance Part One, according to your book. Ringo Starr. He's on the new one too, isn't he? I was hoping that the CD would come before the show, and it came. So I have not looked at. I have not looked at the liner notes yet. So I don't know exactly who played on everything. I know the Cheap Trick guys play. So here's who played on Defiance Part One: Ringo Starr, Jeff Beck, Joe Elliott, Def Leppard, of course, Johnny Depp, Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top, Duff McKagan, Todd Rundgren. Oh, I didn't know Todd Rundgren played on it. Slash, Taylor Hawkins, Andy York from John Mellencamp's band, Mike Campbell. You say Mike Campbell played with John Mellencamp. Is that a typo?
He was, he's with
Tom Petty.
Tom Petty.
Yeah, it says in the book John Mellencamp, so that's a typo. Jeff Tweedy from Wilco.
That's Robert, a reference to York. Andy York is with Mellencamp.
Yeah, underneath it says Mike Campbell, and it has John Mellencamp in parentheses. I don't want to call your publisher out on the misprints, but... Jeff Tweedy from Wilco, Robert Trujillo from Metallica, Waddy Wachtel, famous Waddy Wachtel, just like a wild winged dove, that. Great guitar player, way underrated guitar player, Waddy Wachtel. Brad Whitford from Aerosmith, Dune Clark, also John Mellencamp on drums.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Billy Bob Thornton played drums? I didn't know Billy Bob Thornton was a drummer. I thought he was a guitar player. J.D. Andrew from the Boxmasters, Dean DeLeo from Stone Temple Pilots, Robert DeLeo, Stone Temple Pilots, Eric Kretz, Stone Temple Pilots, guys from the Ramp Band. Yeah. Well, as they say, a murderer's row of celebrity guitar of musicians.
Right. So if you're a musician, who do you want recognition from, the snooty writers or your peers?
I just can't. I mean, they're going to wait until he's dead, and then they'll put him in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. That's a bunch of horse shit, man. You know, Paul Rodgers is not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Yeah, and what
probably
a voice,
the most
right?
influential singer of all time of rock.
Yeah. Unbelievable voice.
But many people he influenced are in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Ted Nugent, one of the greatest guitar players, regardless of what you think of his politics, is not in the Rock and Roll. We can go on forever. Rainbow. Ritchie Blackmore, not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. All right, you want to do a track by track? So I figured I would have you, since this book came, and I was planning on doing a track by track the day the record was released anyway, and I thought, why not get Dr. Digital? Do people call you Dr. Digital?
Not to my face, but it's the Doctor of Digital.
What made you think of the Doctor of Digital?
Well, because in terms of business and technology, everything is digital. So with the academic background, that's the doctor part. And then with everything being digital and digitized, I said, yeah, okay, I'm just going to invent myself and come up with something to brand myself.
When I do a geek out session on Ian Hunter, I'm gonna read along with the book. I just got it. Like I said, I just got it like 3 days ago, so I haven't had a chance to read it yet. But I promise you I will, Mick. Mick, Digital Doctor G. I'll call you G. No, I'll call you Mick. Is that Mick? Okay to call you Mick?
Yeah, of course. All right.
Where in San Diego, what part of San Diego do you live?
Well, if anybody is local, San Carlos is the neighborhood. And also I got Coles Mountain right behind me. Some people would know that. That's really close.
I recently played in San Diego with this band I was on tour with, and we played right on this strip. It was right along the beach. I don't know what that's.
There's a bunch. I don't know. Pacific Beach, Mission Beach, Imperial Beach. Yeah, there's a bunch of them.
Yeah, I don't remember the name of the place. I also played with the Casbah a few times. Did you know that place?
Yeah, I know that place. Yep.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's. Let's do it track by track. So I'm going to tell you the Rock and Roll Geek scoring system. I don't know if you know it or not, but this is something I made up. I mean, it's not a big deal. It's kind of unscientific, but it usually works out pretty well. So in this case, there are 10 tracks on the album. If I like a song, I give it a plus one. I'm going to do two columns here because the doctor is on one column and me on the other. If I like the song, I give it a plus one. If it's okay, we give it a half. And if it sucks, give it a zero. And then we tally that number up and we put that over the amount of tracks that are on the album. In this case, it'd be easy because there's only 10 tracks on the album. I heard there's two, excuse me, I'm burping, it was fine, Pacifico. I heard there's two bonus tracks on the vinyl.
There's three on the vinyl.
Have you heard those bonus tracks? Because I have not.
They're coming up tomorrow, I guess. It says it's a record store release.
Ah, that's right. Oh, is record store tomorrow?
Yeah.
Record store day's tomorrow, huh? Okay.
Yes, friends, it's on the 20th.
By the way, friends, I'm not going to thank the donors on this episode, but please keep the donations coming, and I appreciate everybody who's donated. I promise you I will do it on the next show. I don't usually do that when I have somebody on the show, and this was kind of a, yeah. By the way, thank you again, Doctor, for coming on. I really appreciate it.
I would not miss this for the world.
Yeah, sure. What did you have planned before I asked you to come on for Friday night?
I cleared my schedule for the show.
Are you married?
No, I'm not.
How long have you been divorced?
Actually, I'm not divorced.
Oh. She asked for a divorce. She asked for a divorce. So you're still married?
No.
You're not. So you just got, didn't feel like, why go through the legalities? We're not going to remarry, so might as well stay married, save some money.
No, it's slightly more tragic than that. I am actually a widower.
Ah, she died. Well, I'm sorry to hear that.
It's all right. It's just life.
She filed for divorce and then somehow died?
No, there wasn't a divorce at all. Or just passed away.
Hmm. Well, why is the book about divorce?
Well, it's the podcast, but most of the people, I would say 99% of the people who listen to the second podcast, The Aftermath, are either in the process or have been divorced or trying to get past whatever happened during the divorce.
You have a psychology degree, too?
I do not. No, we have experts to handle that part. So I don't want to give out any advice. I am not qualified.
How often do you do a podcast?
Well, the Doctor of Digital is, like a lot of shows, it's pretty regular. So, I mean, we're weekly. And then with The Aftermath, we try to get one a week, but not often, not all the time. So two or three times a month is probably about our average.
You have a co-host on the Doctor?
On the second one, The Aftermath, I do. And it's kind of interesting how we got connected by a third person. I'm in California, as stated, and she's actually in Ohio, but really great partner, and we've really been able to work very well together. So it's been a very healthy business relationship.
And the Doctor Digital podcast, that's a solo show?
It is, yes. And I interview guests, but it's by myself, so I'm the host of that one.
Is it all interviews?
It's I have done a lot of solo shows, but back a while, I've just tended now to have better interviews and also quality people. So I've tended now to have interviews for quite some time.
Who was the last interview that you did?
I did one on a person who probably is and should be known a whole lot better because they're writing books, as a lot of those folks are. And so with these people that are coming up or the people that I have, I think it's a pretty exciting group. I had one guy on who, I kid you not, was a nuclear submarine commander. He canoed from Pittsburgh to New Orleans. He ran a $100 million manufacturing company. And I said to him, counting up Kilimanjaro, he was climbing it. And I said, really, did you just sit around and watch TV and eat bonbons all day? No, he's accomplished all kinds of stuff like this. So, yeah, pretty interesting guy.
So it's not musicians and rock stars and things like that. It's just other people, normal walks of life type people.
Well, business related, technology related, authors. And, since I'm such a music freak, I mean, I'd love to have more musicians on. And I had actually a person who is from Ireland who had me on her show. So, I mean, yes, I do interact with musicians, but I'm more of a writer, right? So, okay. I mean, I tend to have more contacts with those folks.
All right. So you ready? Enough of my talking. Are you ready to do a track by track of the new Ian Hunter album? Defiance Part 2. So you got the Rock and Roll Geek Score System. You got that concept. You're a professor. You don't need me to explain something so silly like that. You got the gist of it, all right?
Yes.
Okay. So there are 10 songs on the album. I have the liner notes here. They're small writing, so I'm going to have... How's my phone doing on the charge? I got 34% left. I think we'll be okay.
All right.
And it's got liner notes. So do you have the liner notes with you as well? Or do you have the CD, or do you just...
I have my notes.
Okay. First, so there's 10 songs. This record is produced by Andy York and Ian Hunter. Andy York did the last one too, right?
Yes, he did. He's been producing the last several, which I think is just phenomenal because he's a terrific producer.
And people that played on the album, Jeff Beck, Mark Bosch. Mark Bosch, he's from the Rant Band, is that right?
Yes, he is. He's lead guitarist for the Rant Band.
Andy Burton, is he from the Rant Band?
He has been. So he had been on it, and then there's another gentleman, but he has been a part of the Rant Band.
And Dane Clark, Phil Collins from Def Leppard, Johnny Depp, Dean DeLeo, Robert DeLeo, Stone Temple Pilots, Dennis DeBrisi, Joe Elliott, Def Leppard, Morgan Fisher. He was the bass player for what did he play in Mott the Hoople?
Keyboards. He's a fine gentleman, and he also does voiceovers. I mean, he needs a voiceover. David Attenborough type. Nice guy.
Taylor Hawkins, Steve Holly, Eric Kretz, Tommy Mandel, David Mansfield, James Mastro, Brian May, Rick Nielsen from Cheap Trick, Paul Page. Who's Paul Page?
He is a bass player, and that is a really fine individual. Very friendly. I've talked to Paul numerous times before and after gigs. He is from the Rant Band. Great guy.
Tom Peterson from Cheap Trick, Tony Shanahan, Ben Mott Tench from Tom Petty, Billy Bob Thornton, Waddy Wachtel, Lucinda Williams, Robin Zander, and his son is also on it. It says and family. I think it's his son. And Andy York and me. Me being Ian Hunter. All right, first song, People. This was the first single that came out. Was it the first or second one?
I believe it's the first one.
This song, I already tell you, this song is... All right, I'll just play a little bit. Stop. This song is so fucking good. Pardon my language, Dr. Digital, or Nick.
That's okay. I've heard that before.
I'm sorry. I got to stop cursing, but I can't help it. All right. People featuring, it says featuring Joe Elliott, but here's who played on it. I can't believe that's what they're using, featuring Joe Elliott. Here's who played on this. Dane Clark on drums, Tom Peterson on bass, Robin Zander, keyboard and background vocals. Robin Taylor Zander on background vocals. Rick Nielsen from Cheap Trick on rhythm and lead guitars. Mark Bosch on electric guitar. Joe Elliott and Ian Hunter. No mention of Cheap Trick on the MP3s. All right, People. Automatic comes out of the gate. Hook. Can you hear this okay?
No. I can hear fine.
All right.
It's the gospel according to whichever channel you're listening to. The battle for the hearts and minds, selling grown-ups nursery rhymes, and we fall for it every time, 'cause we're consumers of marketing. Marketing, marketing is everything, yeah. Division is a bad idea. You must believe everything that you hear. When we used to laugh before they sold us in half, we need the laugh for decency. We know what people want. We know
No, you don't. Man, that is so fucking catchy. We know what people want. No, you don't. 84 years old. And still got a punk rock attitude. No, you don't.
No, you don't. No, you don't. No, you don't. And I am not 11. We know what people want. We know what people want. I said, no, you don't. No, you don't. No, you don't.
You make me want to throw
up. You make me want to throw up. That is such a great line. God, that is good, man. I'm going to let it go a little bit longer. We got to get to Rick Nielsen's guitar solo.
Sticking out like a sore thumb. And I went down super big.
God, got to be one of the best lyricists in the history of rock and roll. Not in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Of supervision. A karaoke one-man band. How to give that man.
It's got sarcasm, it's got humor, it's got anger. You got any comments, Doctor?
Well, I'm going to guess that you sort of like the tune.
Yeah, we'll let it go a little bit longer. This is a big plus. This is a big, big, huge, massive plus one. A big, all right, enough. I'm trying to make up double entendres for large penis, but you know what I'm saying. Sorry. The finger.
We know what people want.
Man, that is good.
We know what people want. Now you don't. Now you don't. Now you don't. Cause we ain't on your medical.
All right, go Rick Nielsen. By the way, in the chorus, you can hear Robin Zander and his son sing. It sounds like Cheap Trick, the backing band.
Watching ads for Ask Your Doctor. In between a fear and hate, we're gonna celebrate. And Madison Avenue is raking in the money and marketing. Marketing, marketing is everything, yeah. We know what people want.
All right, take it down. So Dr. Digital Nick Smith.
Yeah.
Sorry. Are you laughing at me? I'm not trying to be a joke or anything. I know you think I'm a joke, but
I'm having a great time. I'll tell you.
What do you think of this song? Hey, this is the Rock and Roll Geek Show. This is what I do. This is why I'm in the Podcast Hall of Fame, by the way.
I can tell.
Have you ever heard a podcast like the Rock and Roll Geek Show? Do you listen to podcasts?
I do, yes.
What are some of the podcasts you listen to?
Well, what I try to do is to not say this is the great things they're doing, but I try to steal what they're doing because there's a lot of them that are a lot better than I am, so I want to imitate them.
Have you ever heard one like Rock and Roll Geek Show?
I have to say that this is a very unique show, so yes. I'm honored to be here.
Do you know when I was doing a podcast, there were about 6 podcasts, including mine.
I believe it.
You could say I'm an original, but you could also say this podcast sucks too. I mean, I don't mind if you can say it sucks. Most people do think it sucks. If you read some of the YouTube review or the podcast, iTunes reviews. I haven't read them lately because I got tired of looking at the bad reviews, but you know.
Let me just say, Michael, that people don't know what they want, and they don't always recognize quality. So what can you say?
Yeah. See, the thing is, I don't really care if they like it or not. That's probably what's why I have such nice people who stay loyal to the podcast. Where am I going with this? I don't fucking know, man. You still with me?
I'm with you. Right. I think the song, I could like to give it a 2, but it's a hits off the entire LP, the whole release. I think the sequencing, again, just to try to anticipate where we go, it's phenomenal. But yeah, this is a track you want to lead an album off of.
Yes, no, this question. Is a big, big plus one. Big, yeah. Big, 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 massive plus one. I can't say enough about this song. The song is great. Now, when I first I played it on when it first came out, and I liked it. The more I listen to it, the more I like it. And I was walking the dogs this morning, and because I pre-ordered it on Amazon, and so you get, and when midnight you can download the album. So I listened to it on when I was walking the dogs at 5:30 a.m. this morning, and I was feeling a little bit disappointed. I was saying, "Oh, these songs, I don't know if I like them that much." And then I listened to it the second time and the third time, and so I suggest everybody listen to it this album more than once.
Yep.
But go ahead.
I got a point here, Jeff, because here's what I tell people. I said, you know, obviously I am an Ian Hunter fan, right? I write a book about the guy. So
but that would make you more critical, actually. If you're a super fan, you should be more critical.
Well, maybe, because I was just going to say, I said, along the same lines, I have listened to the first listening of his releases, and I say almost the same thing at times. Like, okay, well, that's okay. And then I listen to it a second time, a third time, a fourth time, and I go, holy moly, that is fantastic.
You start hearing the lyrics, you start listening to the lyrics, you start hearing subtleties and realize the brilliance of this guy. You know how lucky we are to have Ian Hunter still alive?
I say the same thing all the time. That's why I say he's a Lifetime Achievement Award. I mean, who else? Here's a guy that was seeing all the top rock and roll artists of the late 50s. He saw them all, Buddy Holly, Jerry Lee Lewis, Little Richard, everybody. And then he's still around. Are you kidding me? I mean, how fortunate can we be?
And he's a true, true, true original.
There's nobody like him.
And I miss Mick Ronson too. They were a great pair together.
There's some really phenomenal things. One song I love about Ronson, many of them, but I'd Give Anything to See You. That is just such a fantastic song. It's unbelievable how good the sound is.
Of which song?
I'd Give Anything to See You.
Oh, okay. What is that? What's that one on?
I believe it's on Showtime.
Okay. Oh, it's a live album. Is that Showtime a live album?
I don't think all of them. I think there are some that are live.
So you give this one a plus one.
Yeah, obviously. Right. Strong single.
Next song, Fiction. When I was walking the dogs, I was saying, well, this sounds a little bit like the song I just heard. But then after the third listen, it doesn't sound anything like it. Or maybe there might be a little bit of a chord change that's similar, but the song's Fiction. Oh, let's see who's playing on this one here. Okay. Dane Clark drums and China cymbal. They give him credit for China cymbal. Dane Clark, is he the Rant Band?
No, not. He's not.
Who'd Dane Clark play with?
He's younger than me, so a lot of those guys, I don't know all of them.
Steve Holly, tambourine, toms, and cymbal swell. David Mansfield, strings and string arrangement. Morgan Fisher, piano solo, keyboard player for Mata Hoople. Andy York, bass, 12-string, baritone and electric guitar, and Ian Hunter on piano. All right, Fiction. This is on Fiction. Here we go. Fiction. Oh. All right, okay. Podcast Hall of Famer.
I am your fiction man. I'm your very own potential.
Steve Holly, or no, David Mansfield Strings, they make this song. It's great. People that played on this album, they gotta be like, how does this guy have so much fucking talent to write quality songs like this? Most of the people that are on this album, and even Cheap Trick, I'm a huge Cheap Trick fan, they're my favorite band, but they don't have the consistency of Ian Hunter. All right, Mick Smith, Dr. Digital, what do you give Fiction?
Yeah, I got to say, it's one that you got to listen to, but it's deep in terms of the lyrics. It does have some really awesome arrangement there. David Mansfield, Morgan Fisher. I mean, come on, there's a lot of great stuff in there. The lyrics, stirring string arrangement, vibrant spirit. I mean, what is he talking about? You're Fiction Man, I'm not in love, but then what's normal? That's got me thinking. Yeah, got to go with a good track also. It's a one.
So you give it a plus one. I give it a big plus one, too. When I was listening to it, Walking the Dogs, that's okay. But it has grown on me. It only took two times, the second time around, for it to grow on me. I give it a big plus one, too, as well. All right, next song, Third Rail, featuring Jeff Beck and Johnny Depp. They always play together. I think because they were on tour together at the time, or I don't know. Maybe they were just hanging out. I feel like Johnny Depp kind of glommed onto this. What do you think, Doctor?
Well, I think it was an interesting interplay because I'm still thinking of Depp as an actor, but he is a big Hunter fan, but I do like the interplay between the two, and also it's nice it was dedicated to Jeff because I think this was one of those last tracks ever.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to see if I can hear where Johnny Depp is playing. Now the song they played on part one, that was my favorite song of the album. The one about his dad, right?
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Make a Man Out of Me. That song is great.
Awesome. It's like Ships, but it's another level. And it's also, that was a real surprise. How can you take all of this anger and fury and then make it so mellow and peaceful? Yeah, yeah. Like, unbelievable.
And Ian Hunter's voice sounds so good. I mean, you think your grandfather is putting out this album.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Right? It's unbelievable.
Dane Clark on drums, Tony Shanahan bass, Jeff Beck on lead guitar, Johnny Depp acoustic and electric rhythm guitars. I'm going to have to see if I can pick those guitars out. Ian Hunter on piano. All right. The third rail. When I was walking the dogs this morning, I did not like this song, but it's grown on me. So let's listen to it again. See what it makes. Oh, I keep turning it down so I can talk to you. So let me back it up here. Okay. Right off the bat, even when I was walking the dogs, the guitar's great. It's unmistakable. It's great, the guitar part. I'm going to listen, see if I can hear Johnny Depp's playing. Yeah, I can hear Johnny Depp. He's a sloppy guitar player. He plays in the Hollywood Vampires, too, and he's sloppy. But I guess that's his style. Did you know that he originally moved to L.A. with a band from Miami, Florida?
I believe I knew that at one time. Yeah, I think so.
The Rock City Angels was the name of his band. And the Rock City Angels put out a double album without Johnny Depp on it. That was a good album the Rock City Angels did, but he wasn't on it. Yeah. So I can tell. All right, I'll give Johnny Depp credit. His rhythm sounds... It sounds okay.
She was on her way home from a hard day at work. She stood on the platform clutching her purse.
Now, when I was walking, I know I'm going to keep saying walking dogs. When I was walking, I was like, yeah, this isn't that catchy. Now, after I listened to it, I'm on probably round number five now. Just that, not even halfway through the verse, it's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. Back it up a little bit.
From a hard day at work, she stood on the platform, clutching her purse. He came out of nowhere, threw her away like a rag. I saw the doctor, I saw the nurse, I saw the preacher, I saw the nurse. It's with me forever, I'll never
there you go. The third rail. What do you give it, Nick?
I'm going to go with a comment here. It reminds me of Morpheus from part one, which it was like, to me, an okay kind of song. But then I started listening to it, and I like it more and more. And I'm going to say it's so similar to this one here, the third rail. I'm going to still go with the thumbs up, and I like it. And this one has been around for a while. When in 2020 was about to tentatively entitled Overview with tracks, including the third rail, that turned out to be Defiance part one, but here it is on part two. So I think Ian was working on it for a while, and I think it helps to have a little bit more time with a song.
At, he's not going to tour this album, he said. He said he might do like some acoustic storytelling shows. I guess he feels like he's too old to tour. In 2016, he played at the Fillmore down the street from where I was playing. I wanted to go, and I was really upset I could not go because my band had a gig down the street. And I almost took a chance of being late for my gig so I could catch a few songs from Ian Hunter, but... I'm afraid to say we probably won't see Ian Hunter play any of these songs live. Maybe on YouTube or something.
Well, it's the acoustic, as he suggested. He's got tinnitus, and I think the physician has said you really have to follow direction at this point. And that's what he meant by only doing possibly an acoustic tour or like a singer-songwriter type event. I saw him once with Graham Parker, and that was really pretty awesome.
You know, when you have tinnitus at 84 years old, do you really care what the doctor says?
Yeah, well, it depends if you want to hear or not.
Yeah, he probably just doesn't feel like, why bother traveling? He's probably got enough money. All right, I give it a, so you give it a plus one or a half or a zero?
I'm going to give it a plus, but it's because it's one of those songs that kind of hit the theme here. Something you got to listen to, and I would go back. It sounds a lot to me like Morpheus, which was okay, and I like it more and more as I hear it. Same thing with this tune. And again, I go with the lyrics. Very interesting, very intriguing, and that's why I still got to go with a one.
All right, I'll give it a plus one as well. Next song, This Ain't Rock and Roll. It's a good title. Says featuring featuring Phil Collin. I guess that's the big name. Phil, all he's doing is singing a little bit of background vocals. Phil Collin from Def Leppard. Dane Clark on drums, Tony Shanahan bass, Phil Collin, Andy York on guitar, and Ian Hunter on piano. All right, This Ain't Rock and Roll. Little bit of a feel of, I guess he would probably call this the rocker, but a little bit like All the Way from Memphis or Once Bitten, Twice Shy. I guess that's what you would call it. Well, listen to it. Again, when I was walking the dogs, it's all right. I like it now. I'm already blowing my wad. I'm giving it a plus one before it even starts.
Some came out of the songs they sang, chopping up stones on the chain gang, gospel wailing as good as it gets. Ain't no faces, nothing but necks.
Kind of a, I guess, a standard Mott the Hoople, Ian Hunter type song. What do you think of this one, Mick?
Yeah, but see, I almost go, this could have been a single too for me. And I like what he's saying, that he's kind of philosophical, which he is at this point. And it's like, hey, rock is not as popular as it used to be, but hey, you know, it's just something else is around. I don't know what to call it, but here it is. It's for young people.
Yeah. It's like they don't ride them like that anymore, I guess is what he's saying.
Yeah, they don't ride them. It's just not there anymore.
What do you give it, Mick?
I almost liked it before I heard it. So I just got, it's a one.
All right, plus one.
Could have been a single.
I'm going to give it a plus one, too. So far, we're 4 for 4. I'm going to try something here. I got Alexa here. Alexa, read me a review of Ian Hunter Defiance Part 2. Come on, Alexa. Come on, Alexa.
Defiance Part 2. Fiction is a captivating album that showcases Ian Hunter's artistic brilliance. The album, which features notable collaborations with Brian May, Taylor Hawkins, Joe Elliott, and Jeff Beck, is a testament to Hunter's enduring talent and his ability to bring together a diverse group of musicians to create a cohesive and compelling musical experience. The album's opening track, Precious, is a highlight, with its catchy melody and thought-provoking lyrics. The song's vibrant energy is enhanced by the contributions of Brian May's mesmerizing guitar work and Taylor Hawkins' dynamic drumming. Likewise, Fiction, the album's title track, is a dynamic and ambitious.
All right, I'm bored with Alexa. All right, Alexa, stop. Why did I do that? I don't know. I did it.
I like the dress she was wearing.
Yeah. I did it earlier, and it was a better bit than what I just tried to do. Hey, Alexa, who is the doctor of digital?
From Apple.com. Brian Cook promo episode.
Okay, all right, okay. Alexa, stop. Try one more time. Alexa, who's the doctor of digital?
From Apple.com.
Okay, all right. She never heard of you, doctor. Sorry.
Well, I asked her out. She said no.
Alexa, who's Michael Butler?
Michael Butler is a former American theatrical producer. He is famous for doing the producing job in the rock musical Hair.
There you go. See, did you know that about me, Dr. Digital?
Actually, I did.
Alexa, who the fuck is Michael Butler? She didn't like that too much. All right. Next song. Weed.
Precious, I believe. Is it?
Oh, Precious. That's right. Precious. Oh, this was also released before the album came out.
Yeah, I'm sorry. This was the first single.
Yeah. This is Brian May on guitar. Joe Elliott singing background, James Maestro sax, and Taylor Hawkins on drums. This was the first single or second single?
This was the first, yeah.
Alexa, stop. Okay, Precious.
I look in the mirror.
Big plus one.
What do I see? Hey, no magna cum laude. Staring back at me. Qualifications leave a lot to be desired. I guess I fall way below the standard required. Yeah, only take a minute. Only take a minute.
Catchy as hell chorus.
He's
got that guitar, the bleep, bleep. It's a little David Bowie Heroes type guitar. Brian Eno sounding guitar.
A minute, only take a minute or two.
Or Robert Fripp, whatever.
It'll only take a minute, only take a minute of your precious time. But you always got something a little more precious to do.
That's a great tail end of a chorus. Feel free to chime in whenever you want to, Doctor.
Yeah, I just go, yeah, kind of obvious single. I love James Mastro's sax abuse is what he's credited with. And to get into the Rant Band, needed somebody to play mandolin, and I Wish I Was Your Mother, and James went and learned it and got in the gig just because of that.
Huh. There you heard it from the Doctor of Digital right there, friends. That's some authority. You know everything about Ian Hunter, don't you?
I know the songs about Ian Hunter.
Is he your favorite artist of all time? Who's your favorite?
Yeah. No, there's no question.
Ian Hunter is. Okay.
Yes. When I was writing the book, and people have asked questions about it, said, how long did it to write? And I said, well, 50 years and 9 months. Like, what do you mean by that? I go, well, I've been listening for 50 years. It took 9 months to write. So there you go.
Have you done other podcasts promoting the book? Is the book out yet?
It's coming out, I believe, in several days. I think it was the 24th was the last that I understood. You can pre-order. It's on Amazon now. You can just pre-order whenever they ship it. It's coming.
Too bad you couldn't have waited until part two came out, Defiance Part 2.
And I've asked the publisher, like, okay, we get second edition here. What are we doing? This guy is still recording. He's still alive and still doing quality music. So, you know, hey, let's keep going.
And the publisher said, let's see how first pressing does, right?
Yeah, but he didn't know he was going to be on Michael Butler's show. So now we'll see what happens.
Do you know what the name of this show is? You know what my podcast is called?
Yeah, Rock and Roll Geek.
All right, there you go. Good. Thank you. All right, finish Precious here. Oh, that's a great tale. I'm going to back it up to the whole chorus. This is brilliant songwriting. Man, I wish I could write a song like this. Only take a minute or two. It'll only take a minute. Only take a minute of your precious time. But you always got something a little more precious to do. Did you know that Johnny Depp did the painting on the cover?
I did know that, yes. I guess he paints as well. He does other things.
Pretty good job. Did he do the first cover too?
No, that was another gentleman. I can't remember the name, but it was somebody else.
All songs written by Ian Hunter and only Ian Hunter. No co-writers. This guy's a fucking genius.
Forget Alpha or Beta. Mensa, beware.
There you go. All right. That's a big plus one for me. How about you, Nick?
Yep, I'm going to say something about his background in a couple of ways. And when you're asking about what do you know, okay, I'll tell you about his songs. Here's a gentleman who has been married for a very long time in a very long, loving marriage, and he still's writing love songs to his wife. That is really precious. But what is he writing about here? He's writing about rejection and not giving enough time of your precious time. It reminds me of Irene Wilde and Arms and Legs, two other songs that he wrote. And he's talking about, yeah, why don't you just give me a little bit of time in a self-depreciating manner? Tells me about that the things that happened when he was a young person, he's still carrying with him, but he's still thinking about it and writing great songs that every young man, 15, 16 years old, can relate to. And he's 84, folks. Come on. What a great songwriter.
You intellectualize it. I like that. I just take it as he's got some sarcasm and a little bit of snarkiness still at 84 years old. But
that's a Jerry Lee Lewis influence.
Yeah. That is a great tune. Really great tune. All right. The next song is featuring the guys in Stone Temple Pilots, which I'm not a huge fan of those guys. The song is called Weed. Eric Kreitz on drums, Robert DeLeo bass, Dean DeLeo, Andy Burton organ, Dennis DeBreezy. Okay. Weed. Guy from Stone Temple Pilots, good, decent slide player.
Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. We don't need your blood, your sweat or your tears. It's the end of an era, a new age begun, and you're the unfortunate ones. So bring us your billionaires, fake diplomats, bring us your gangsters and aristocrats. Got all the best lawyers money can buy, and they'll get you off in the blink of an eye. Hardwards and upwards, the name of the game. Hardwards and upwards, with no sense of shame. There'll always be somebody else we can blame. We're invincible. To breathe, so let them all, let them all, let them smoke weed.
So, first listen, let get through a slide for you. All right, good slide playing guy. So here's what I think it means. For at first listen, I think it's just about song about weed.
Mm-hmm.
You tell me if I'm wrong, because I'm not the I'm not as smart as some people, but I think it's about the government wants everybody doped up so they're too stupid to know what's going on.
See how smart you are? That's exactly what I was thinking, because I first hear, and that's why I got to go right away. It's like, what a great insight, because you think it's going to be his typical thing, like, okay, yeah, we all should be smoking weed and like, just we're all going to be cool. But no, he quotes Shakespeare, Caesar, lend me your ears. Romans, lend me your ears. There's a new age coming, and we're invincible. So, hey, why don't you guys, you don't have to read, you have technology. You can just take drugs and tune out, and we're going to run the world.
Very well said, Dr. Digital. Yes, it's a great, it's brilliance. I hate to use that, keep working using that word brilliance, but it's really, really clever songwriting from Ian Hunter. All right, listen to more.
It's a nightmare scenario, guns by-
So I'm right, correct, Doctor?
What was that?
I'm correct about my thoughts about the lyrics.
Well, in my humble opinion, you agree with me, so you must be right.
Okay, there you go.
Guns by the bed, but we got the drones flying over your head. Is this freedom of speech? Is this freedom of hype?
I hope you don't find out until it's too late. Here comes a new language you don't understand. Chaos promoted, common sense banned. Supply and demand, by supply and demand. We're invincible.
I'm not going to play everyone all the way through because we'll be here forever. But what do you give it?
Yeah, I got to go with the one because it's got that insight in terms of the lyrics, and it's something that you don't expect. And there he goes, very insightful. And yes,
and it's catchy. When I was
catchy.
When the at first listen, I didn't really like it. Now I really like it a lot. We're 6 for 6. 6 out of 6 are already most bands now or artists. If they have 6 good songs on their album, it's a classic. So we're at 6 already.
Got it.
Next song, Kettle of Fish, featuring Taylor Hawkins, but it's got the guys in Cheap Trick. It's got Dane Clark on drums, Tom Peterson on bass, Robin Zander background vocal, Rick Nielsen rhythm and lead guitars, and Tommy Mandel organ, Andy York, and Ian Hunter on piano. Kettle of Fish. That's unmistakable Tom Peterson bass.
Definitely.
I wish that the guitars were louder because Robin or Rick Nielsen's playing some great guitar parts. I wish it was louder.
Rise to the
kettle of fish. What do you give this, Dr. Digital?
Well, with that crunchy guitar and a great bass, I mean, my goodness, it's really hard to say anything but a one with just the music itself. But when I start listening to the lyrics, I go, oh my gosh, what is he talking about? Can't stand the scorcher, leave the water, can't drink the water. What's going on to our planet and our world? I think it's a general view of things are going astray, folks. You better wake up.
So you give it a plus one?
I give it a plus one.
All right. When I was listening to it the first time, I said, this song, I was thinking about a zero, and I'm like, am I going to really give a zero to it? After listening to it for the fifth time, I'm at a strong half. I'm going to keep it a half because I need to keep my rock credibility, so I'm going to just give it a half. But it grows. I like it better every time I hear it, so probably one more listen, and I'll probably be a plus one. It sounds almost like a Cheap Trick song.
It's true.
Sounds like a song that Cheap Trick might have written. That's why I was surprised that they didn't have songwriting credits on this, because it sounds like I'm trying to put a thing. What Cheap Trick album it would be on? I don't know, but I like it. But I'm going to just give it a half to keep my credibility. I love Rick Nielsen's playing on it. I wish Robin Zander's background vocals were louder, and I wish the lead the guitar was louder as well. Bass is way loud, but yeah. All right, so a half for me. Next song, What Would I Do Without You, featuring Lucinda Williams and Benmont Tench. Let's see who plays on this. Dane Clark drums, Lucinda Williams lead and background vocals, Benmont Tench organ, Tom Shanahan bass, Andy Burton piano, electric piano, Andy York guitar. Okay. What Would I Do Without You? I'm thinking this is a love song to his wife, Trudy. Doesn't this sound like another Ian Hunter song to you?
Yeah, it comes off right, much like any Hunter song, and it's a love song.
Yeah.
Definitely. It was one.
Musically, it sounds like another song.
Yeah.
The longer we go on, the better it gets. What would I do without you? You are my light, my cause and effect.
Think about this one, Mick.
Well, here's the deal with this. I think it's very difficult to talk about love without being sappy, but he's managed to do it, and definitely believe this is one of those things. 50 years later, he's still writing love songs to his wife. That's pretty unbelievable and awesome. I would have arranged it a little differently, and I think some of the arrangements would be kind of what you said with Kettle of Fish. I would have rearranged this a little bit more, but it's still, I think, a strong song.
What do you think about Lucinda Williams' vocals?
Well, I see how much Ian appreciates her. I would think maybe there's where I would have changed things around a little bit. I'm not quite sure it works. It doesn't quite pull it off for me. But again, it's a personal side for me. But what I would say is I'm willing to bet this song, if people would listen to it, it would be a great wedding song. And I could see people using this in weddings.
So what do you give it, a plus one, a half, or a zero?
I'm going to have to keep my rock intellectual credibility. I'm just going to say a half.
All right. I'm going to give it a plus one. I like the song. Here's my problem with it. Lucinda Williams is a great singer. I think she's doing an Ian Hunter imitation in this song. She's trying too hard to sound like Ian Hunter. That's my opinion. So I don't think she did a great job on it. Let's listen a little bit more. Almost out of key on it. I think she's doing that on purpose. But I'm still going to give it a plus one because I think it's a good song. Well-written song.
Yep. Good song, but I think we're picking up on somewhat similar that in that there's something about the arrangement, something about the way it comes across. It could have been slightly different and improved.
All right, next song. We got two more songs. Everybody's Crazy But Me. Taylor Hawkins on drums, Waddy Wachtel, the great Waddy Wachtel on guitar, Ben Montench again on organ, Steve Molly, maracas and tambourine, Paul Page bass, James Meister electric guitars, Dennis DeBrizzi, and Andy York background vocals, Ian Hunter piano. Okay, Everybody's Crazy But Me. Little Stonesy sound.
Hello, hello, hello.
Come on. When I first heard this one, I didn't like it that much, but listen to hello, hello, hello. That's great.
Sounds like another song.
What?
Sounds like another song.
Yes, it does.
How he opens up. Boom. Hello, hello, hello.
Yes.
Looks like we got.
That's a great guitar riff, too.
Knickers in a twist.
Knickers in a twist. Makes a total left turn melodic here on melody wise. Dr. Digital, what do you give this one?
Yeah, he's the last, but it's crazy, but him, he's the last man standing. There's no more Mott the Hoople. Yeah, gotta go with, like, it's a one.
I give it a big, big, big plus one. This song is great.
We still faith.
84 years old! Bob Dylan. How old's Bob Dylan?
I think Bob might be one or two years younger than Ian.
Bob Dylan ain't got nothing on Ian Hunter.
That's what I say all the time, but I've been saying it for 50 years.
God, that is good. All right, last song, Hope, featuring Taylor Hawkins, Billy Bob Thornton, and Lucinda Williams. Lucinda Williams, is she on this one too?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, she's got harmony vocal. Okay. Taylor Hawkins drums, Billy Bob Thornton background vocals, Ben Montench synthesizer, Steve Molly maracas, J.D. Andrew electric guitar, Andy York. Okay. Last song, Hope. Now, usually on a closing song, you have a little introspective, you know, a slower introspective. Listen to Hope. And this one is too. But that's what you want in Ian Hunter album.
Yep.
Trouble comes to everyone. You gotta hold your head up high. It's so hard to fight it up, no matter how you try. Life is a question of alternative.
So after all the things he's saying about on this album, closes out with, you gotta have hope.
I'm well aware that life ain't fair. You see it all the time.
Ending on a positive note.
Poverty and tears in the finest wine.
What do you give this one, Dr. Digital?
Yeah, it's for what you said. It reminds me very much of Life from When I'm President. It's philosophical. Uh-huh. Life is not fair, but you got to have hope. It's a cardinal virtue. Hope, love, charity. Yep, it's a one.
Did you take notes before this show?
Yes, I did. Why?
You sound like you're knew what to say.
I'm almost like an academic.
Yes. Way smarter than this idiot host. Dr. Digital.
We're agreeing a lot, though.
Yes. So I give it. So I'm tallying them all up here. I have a 9.5 out of 10. You have a 9.5 out of 10.
Yes, indeed.
Friends, I'll say it again. 9.5 out of 10. Possibly the best album of the year. That was my Defiance Part 1 was my number one album of last year. I do a top 10 at the end of the year. Do my top 10. Defiance was number one. Part 2 will probably be up there as well. Friends, thank you for listening. Dr. Digital's book, Nick Smith, Ian Hunter, Every Album, Every Song, On Track. Is it called On Track or Ian Hunter, Every Album, Every Song?
On Track, Ian Hunter, and also on the cover it does say every song so that people know what they're getting. An analysis of every single song from his solo career has never been done before. I hope that people would like it. And that's my two cents in there.
I'm gonna pause it here before we stop here. Now I'm gonna look up in the book one of my favorite Ian Hunter songs is the title track of When I'm President. So I'm gonna look it up here. Do you remember what page When I'm President's on?
I don't know what page, no.
Man Overboard's a great album, too. Let's see. Okay, Man Overboard. Okay, When I'm President. Okay. The song When I'm President. Let's see.
108.
I'm going to read. Okay. The title track of the CD is a standout, starting from the underdog opening line. This is the knowledge from Mick Smith, the Doctor of Digital. The title track of the CD is a standout, starting from the underdog opening line, Stranger, from the title of the famous 1961 science fiction novel by Robert Heinlein.
Heinlein.
Literature ain't me forte. Sorry, friend. Even if Hunter were Aladdin with the music magic lamp, he couldn't, reading ain't either, by the way, he could not change political and economic conditions. Wow, you really analyzed this one, didn't you? This is the kind of insight you're going to get on this book, friends. Ian's intent, if he were president, would be to lean on the number 1% fat cats, meaning the super rich. Hunter demonstrates an insider's view of American politics, favoring the 28th Amendment. The proposed 28th Amendment means that Congress shall make no laws applies to citizens and does not apply equally to senators and representatives. Currently, politicians are pirates and robbers. You thought I geeked out on this shit, friends. Politicians are pirates and robbers whining that they don't have enough money. His administration would be as significant as the president's on Mount Rushmore, and his ugly mug would be placed there as well. Presidents aspire to be great, but something happens to you up on the hill. If you try to buck the system, you will be subject to torture, as in The Pit and the Pendulum, depicted in the short story by American writer Edgar Allan Poe. Hunter realizes this will never happen, so he ends the song with the phrase, "When pigs fly," a figure of speech so hyperbolic that it describes an impossibility. The song was first called, "But I Will If I..." Okay, now you get into the super rock knowledge here. The song was first called, "But I Will If I Have To," but Ian had no lyrics for it, and he would have lost the melody. Did you find that out on the on the Ian Hunter forums?
There were some other sources. Campbell Devine did a phenomenal work, and I've always been grateful for Adrian Perkins for keeping the Hunter fans knowledgeable. In the 1980s, which was a dark period for all of us.
He then tried the title "When I'm Superman" during an electoral year for Obama in the USA, but Hunter thought this was ostentatious, and he settled for president instead. It's tongue-in-cheek and not much changed anyway. The song is written as if it were a guy in a bar or a pub thinking aloud, "If I were president, here are all the things I would do. I would be great." The statement is that both the political right and left continue to fail. There you go, friends. If you want to super geek out on Ian Hunter songs, this book is for you. On Track, Ian Hunter, Every Album, Every Song by G. Mick Smith, the Doctor of Digital. Mick Smith?
Yes, sir.
How can we reach you? We're going to continue the song before we close out. But so how can we find more from you? What do you call the podcast and the website and all that?
Sure. Okay. The Dr. Digital podcast. I'm also on the Aftermath Custody, Divorce, and Healing. You can always find me online, the Dr. Digital, Facebook, and anywhere else.
The book is not that big. So if you're like me and not much of a reader, the fonts are not that big, but I think you can probably get through this book in a couple of days. And there's lots of photos on the inside too. Good photos in the center. There's a rare photo of Ian Hunter without glasses on, swimming in a pool.
Thank you, Morgan Fisher. Thank you.
I recommend the book to everybody, and let the Doctor of Digital know that you heard him on the Rock and Roll Geek Show, so he doesn't think he wasted 1 hour and 39 minutes of his life.
This was phenomenal. Are you kidding me? I would not have missed this for the world.
Uh-huh. You're too kind, Mick Smith. I appreciate it, friend. All right, let's let this song carry out, and I'll give you my plugs. Oh, by the way, Mick, send me a Facebook message with all the links so I can put them on the show notes. Would you do that for me, please?
You bet. Yes, sir.
I'm going to have this thing posted probably within an hour after we do this thing. All right, thank you, friends, for listening. Rockandrollgeek.com is where you can find this show. Find me on the Facebook, R&R Geek. Find me on the Twitter, R&R Geek. Find me on the Instagram, Rock and Roll Geek, Don't Ask. Please keep the donations coming. I will thank you personally on the next episode. Because without your donations, this show would die a horrible, putrid, stench-filled death. It's a value for value, so if you get any value out of this, please contribute what you can, friends. Because I'm retired / unemployed. Mick Smith, Dr. Digital, thank you for coming on.
Thanks, Michael. Thanks, Cole.
Hang on, I'll say goodbye to you. Don't hang up yet.
It's a rock and roll geek train wreck.
Hold on.